Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
And welcome to all of you in the name of our Savior Jesus. Do you ever get distracted from important things? Do you ever get distracted from your driving by your phone alert telling you you have a text message? Do you ever get distracted from focusing on the needs of your family by the demands of your job? And you, this past week, failed to do a few things you should do because you were going all over looking for Pokemon? Jesus reminds us today what is really important, and he says us one thing, his word. Today he's going to tell us about all the ways we can get distracted to warn us, but above all, he's going to encourage us in all of the reasons why his word is worthy of our hearing, our trusting, and our sharing with others. Let's begin today with an opening that focuses us on the blessings of the Word of God. Let's begin with the gathering right on the Word of God at the bottom of page 1. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
believing you may have life in his name. The scriptures testify about Jesus who lived a perfect life for you, died on the cross to pay for all of your sins, and rose again to assure you of your salvation. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Go back to your seats. Thank you.
18, verses 1 through 14. Have you ever laughed at something that sounded completely ridiculous to you? Sarah laughed at something that sounded completely ridiculous. This idea that she was going to have a child in her old age, in her late 80s, even though that promise came from God. You and I live in a world that often laughs at what God says as ridiculous and scoffs at it. Maybe sometimes we're tempted to do that, at least about certain parts of the Bible ourselves. But in this Old Testament lesson, we are reminded that what God says is never ridiculous, because that promise to give this old man and old woman a child, he kept that promise. And above all, he kept the greatest promise to send you and the rest of the world a Savior. So, know that God's word is always worthy of your trust. The Lord appeared to Abraham near the great trees of Mamre while he was sitting at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. Abraham looked up and saw three men standing nearby. When he saw them, he hurried from the entrance of his tent to meet them and bowed low to the ground. He said, "If I have found favor in your eyes, my Lord, do not pass your servant by. Let a little water be brought, and then you may all wash your feet and rest under this tree. Let me get you something to eat so that you can be refreshed and then go on your way, now that you have come to your servant." "Very well," they answered, "do as you say." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah. "Quick," he said, "get three seahs of fine flour and eat it, and make some bread." Then he ran to the herd and selected a choice, tender calf, and gave it to a servant who hurried to prepare it. He then brought some curds and milk and the calf that had been prepared and set these before them. While they ate, he stood near them under a tree. "Where is your wife Sarah?" they asked him. "There in the tent," he said. Then the Lord said, "I will surely return to you about this time next year, and Sarah, your wife, will have a son." Now Sarah was listening at the entrance to the tent which was behind him. Abraham and Sarah were already old and well advanced in years, and Sarah was past the age of childbearing. So Sarah laughed to herself as she thought, "After I am worn out and my master is old, will I now have this pleasure?" Then the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Will I really have a child now that I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? I will return to you at the appointed time next year, Sarah will have a son." This is our Old Testament lesson. And we'll continue with singing of the Psalm of the Day. It's Psalm 119a on page 111 in the front of our hymnals, a psalm that reminds us of the blessings of God's word.
Thank you.
gospel to others, God's word. Does he convince you that some of the people in your life are just people who wouldn't be into that, or maybe, you know, they just aren't interested in religion, or they never accept what God says in his word? Well, you can be very thankful that the devil wasn't successful in convincing whoever it is shared God's word with you, so you could hear and know and believe the same truth. And you can be very thankful that he doesn't have to convince you either. Because the Apostle Paul is going to remind us that the word of God, the gospel especially, is not only worth our standing on, it is worth sharing with others for their salvation too. Paul writes, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation, if you continue in your faith established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel. This is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. Now I rejoice in what was suffered for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions, for the sake of his body, which is the church. I have become its servant by the commission God gave me, to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. To this end I labor, struggling with all his energy, which so powerfully works in me. This is our epistle lesson. Hallelujah, my word will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Amen. The word of God we focus our attention on today is our gospel lesson for today. It's from Luke chapter 10, verses 38 through 42. Your brothers and sisters in Christ. It was about 8 years ago when a very unusual meeting took place between the president of Bethlehem Steel, Charles Schwab, and the motivational speaker, Ivy Lee. Ivy Lee had called for this meeting, and he wanted to share with Charles Schwab a business proposal that he said was guaranteed to make his company more profitable. So Schwab was all ears. What Lee told him was simply this. He said, what I want you to do tonight is I want you to write down the most important things you need to get done tomorrow and put them in order of importance. And then tomorrow morning, start with number one on the list. And when you get that done, go on to number two, and so on. And if you reach the end of the day and you didn't do everything on the list, that's okay because you'll have accomplished the most important things. And if you think this is something worthwhile, share it with your employees. Let them use it too. And then you can pay me whatever you think is worth. So a couple of weeks later, Denise got a check in the mail for $25,000, which at that time was a lot of money. And all for a business proposal that in the end was just common sense. First things first. You know that's true, actually, don't you? But you're probably sitting here going right now, yeah, I should kind of remember that. First things first every day. I'm not a motivational speaker. And it's not really me who's sending this message to you today, but it's Jesus who's telling you something better than first things first. Jesus' message to you today is first and only first thing first. The one thing needed should be first. And that one thing needed, he tells us, is his word. I mean, we know why, right? Only the word of God gives us the message we need more than anything else, the message of our salvation, God's free and abundant gift to us in Jesus. And only the word of God is able to pour out blessings in every single part of our life. So no matter what part of our life needs help, encouragement, strength, comfort, it's there from the word of God. So let's listen today as Jesus tells us, not put first things first, but put the most important thing, the one thing first. So our lesson begins with Jesus and his disciples dropping by the house of his friends, the siblings, Martha, Mary, and Lazarus. And Martha immediately gets to work. I'm not sure if she even expected these guests, but I want you to imagine you have 13 house guests. You got a little work to do, right? You got dinner to prepare for an additional 13 people. You got to find some place for maybe 13 people to sleep later that night. So I can imagine her, you know, running around in the kitchen trying to get dinner ready, and then quick, you know, while something is put over the fire to cook, she's running and making a bed, and she is just really stressed because there's all this pressure to get all this stuff done. And all of a sudden, she realizes, hey, where's Mary? My sister. She should be helping. She looks in the living room, and there's Mary along with the other disciples sitting there listening to Jesus. Sitting there listening, leaving all the work to Martha. That's when the slow burn starts. Can you picture the anger in her eyes? Those eyes squinting as she bustles about doing her work. Can you hear that clang as she slams the kettle onto the kitchen table? Can you picture or imagine the things she's muttering under her breath as she does this? Until finally she has had enough, and she comes storming into that living room, puts her hands on her hips, and she says to Jesus, Lord, don't you care that I have to do all this work by myself? Tell my sister to help me. Too much to do, too little time, and too little help. Does that sound a little bit like your life? You got all this stuff to do every day. You got meals to make, you got laundry to do, you got a house to keep clean, you've got car, lawn to take care of. You got a spouse to support, maybe you have kids to raise, maybe you have an elderly parent to look after, maybe it's just some friend of yours who needs some support. You've got to go to work, I mean, you've got to make a living, right? You've got to do that. You've got maybe classes you're taking, maybe you have homework to do, you
want a job, and you got your church work to do, you got your volunteer work to do, and I mean, sometimes all of that can just seem so overwhelming, it's so stressful, and it can lead to resentment that you've got all these things on your plate. And so easily from the resentment flows from criticism, right? You look around and you look at the people in your life and you think to yourself, why aren't they helping? How come they're not pitching in? How come all this is falling on me? That's not fair. And maybe it's not a large step to go from there to blaming Jesus just like Martha did. Jesus, where's your head? Can't you see how I'm doing all the work by myself while Mary just sits there? Do your job. Be a loving God. Tell my sister she needs to help me. Can't you see how stressed I am? But let me ask you this. Is our stress sometimes all that unavoidable? Or do we put it on ourselves? Do you put more activity into your schedule than you need to? Maybe some activity that just really isn't even all that necessary? And how well do you use your time? I just read yesterday that the average American spends 4.7 hours a day on their mobile electronic device. That is a quarter of our day, guys. Is that why maybe we feel so stressed or overwhelmed with all we have to do? And how much of it is really all that important anyway? You know what was really bothering Martha? That dinner might end up being at 6:20 instead of 6 o'clock. But that would be a disaster. What if some of the disciples actually had to make their own beds before they went to bed? What if the roast lamb was one shade of brown too dark? That was terrible. You get worked up over stuff that really isn't all that important too? How clean or neat does your house really have to be? Do your kids have to perform to a certain level that puts them over other kids? Do you? How good does your lawn have to look? Sometimes we get worked up over the most unimportant things. Which is why sometimes we need to hear Jesus say to us things like, Norm, you're worried and upset about many things. You're killing yourself here. Stop there. Only one thing is needed. That one thing that's needed is the Word of God. And we could talk the rest of this morning about all the reasons why the Word of God is the one thing we need, but just for the sake of time, let's focus on three key reasons right now. The only thing I really need is the Word of God, because the Word of God helps me see life realistically. The Word of God helps me to understand that my greatest need in my life is the need for God's love and forgiveness. I wouldn't know that apart from the Bible. I would think that the purpose of life is living a life that's as comfortable and convenient and successful and prosperous as it can be. But the real purpose of life is for me to know my Savior and in Him to have salvation. And it helps me clarify all of my values and my priorities, so I don't have to depend on TV ads, I don't have to depend on cultural trends, I don't have to depend on my own sinful thinking to determine what's really important. I can trust Him. So, for example, I don't have to raise my kid like the greatest thing that I can ever do for him is make him the starting shortstop by the time he reaches senior year for the varsity. But much more important is that he's a child of God. And therefore, my effort, my energy, is better put into his faith than making sure he can get a curveball. Another reason why the Word of God is the one thing I need is because it reveals a God to me who's unimaginably more wonderful than I could ever dream him up to be. He's a God who knows how often I jam this stuff into my life and put all this stuff into my life because I'm looking for meaning and significance and earthly getting and earthly doing when all of my needs are met in their greatest way in Him. He knows I do that. And in the process, I put stress on myself. He knows that oftentimes I'm really driven by my ego. I want people to recognize all I got going on in my life, all the balls I'm juggling and how well I'm doing with all of them. He knows how often I put this pressure on myself and then I lash out unlovingly at other people and sometimes even at Him. He knows better than I do that all of that is actually sin, for which I deserve nothing but eternal punishment. And then He reveals to me that He loves me anyway.
that he loved me so much, that he charged his son with all of my wrong thinking and all of my rebellious living, that his son paid for my forgiveness when he died on the cross, just like he paid for yours, to set us free from that guilt we carry around, the shame we carry around, even the fear we carry around, because in our sinful minds we think of it rests on us, sometimes even our standing with God. He died to set you free from that. And he conquered death to set you free from your fear of death. So you can know when this life ends through faith in him, his victory is your victory too. And until he comes back, or until you die, that what he's going to do for you is meet all of your deepest longings in ways that could never be met, even if every single one of the to-do items on your list were checked off and you said, I'm finally on top of things. Speaking of being on top of things, you know all that stress you feel because you never seem to be on top of things? He promises to handle that. So you don't have to stress. And all the pressures you think sometimes are going to crush you, he promises they won't. Because he's going to stand beside you and give you strength. And you know, all of those times you stumble and falter, even though you know his grace is so powerful for you and his promises are so sure, every single day that's forgiven. And will be forever. Because he promised Mary, who chose to listen to his word, all of the promises of his grace would never be taken. Here's one more reason, though, why the Word of God is the one thing we need. The Word of God changes us for the better. You know the story of Juan Chavez, one of the most wanted desperados in Mexican criminal history? He had just done another raid and robbed somebody, and he's back at some cave hiding out. He's got all this loot. And of course, he's got to lay low for a little while, so he's checking out all this loot. He happens to find a Bible. Well, he's got stay low anyway, so he decides he might as well read it a little bit. He would later say he couldn't put it down. He would later say that book changed him completely. And we know that that's true because it was only a few days later that he walked into the courthouse at Saltillo, Mexico to turn himself in. When the judge says, who brought you in? He held up the Bible and said, this book did. I'm here because this book has convinced me of what's important. And that I need to pay my debt to society. Not surprising. The Word of God did the same thing to Mary. You know what happened the next time Jesus visited her house? Right before he was going to go to Jerusalem to suffer and die for her sins and the sin of the world, and she knew that? The Word of God motivated her to take a bottle of perfume worth a year's wages. Have you got that figure in your mind that you can make in a year? And she poured it out. All those sweet-smelling contents over her sweet Savior in willing joy and thanks for what you do for her. Of course, I didn't have to tell you those stories because you know the power of the Word of God in your own life. It's what's making you think right now, you know, I should be the husband or the wife God wants me to be. I should be a parent. I should be a son or daughter God wants me to be. I should give my pastor a call and tell him, you know, it's great to come and hear everything that Jesus has done for me, but I've got to do something to show him my thanks. What can I do here to shepherd other girls to help share his gospel with others, to serve others? It's what is making us think, you know, I don't want to bring offerings that are more leftovers than the first and the best, just like Mary gave to Jesus her first and her best. It's what leads you and I to say, you know what, I'm going to open my mouth that I've kept shut for far too long, and speak those words of reconciliation between me and my friend that he or she needs to hear. It's the Word of God that inspires us to say, I want to live a life that pleases my Savior because of what he did for me. To find our joy in doing just that. I think Martha recognizes that the Word of God is that rich in blessings. But she had stuff to do. You know, she really wanted to be married. She wanted to sit there and listen to Jesus, but there was just too much to do. Except that in the end, the real problem was not she had too much to do. She made a choice. But that was more important than listening to Jesus. That happens to me sometimes. Doesn't happen to you. You have those moments where you say, I should really read my Bible regularly like I used to. You have those moments where you say, we should go to a Bible class. You have those moments where you say, you know, I kind of am not going to churches regularly because I really should. I should really do that. If that doesn't happen, we don't score points any more than Martha did for good intentions. We have to recognize that in the end, we make a decision. And sometimes that decision is from a sinful nature that says, this or this or this or this is more important. But Mary made the right decision. And actually, you've made the right decision today. You're here. And you have the Holy Spirit living in you to continue to lead you to make the right decision. Because you know what you get from the Word of God. Not only the certainty of your forgiveness, not only the promise of eternal life, not only the assurance of God's unfailing love, but blessings that flow into every part of your life. Power to focus on the right thing, power to be equipped to do the right things in your life and give it to the Lord. Like you want to do out of love and thanks to Him. So tonight when you face that choice, when you see your Bible on the end table, when you see it on the bedside stand, when you walk into your kid's room and you see that children's Bible on the shelf, or just next Sunday when it's a beautiful day and you got some projects you can catch up on, or you can just get out to the park and enjoy the day, and you're going to make a choice, remember that the right choice means you'll be sitting at the feet of Jesus. You'll be sitting at the feet of the God who is holy for you to make you holy. The God who offered that holy life for your forgiveness at the cross. The God who's going to take care of you every single day and give you just what you need through His Word. The God who makes you eager to hear and believe. Mary has chosen what is better, and it will not be taken away from her. That's true for you too. Amen. Please stand. May the peace of God, which transcends understanding, guard your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Please join with me as we confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated. At this time, please sign our friendship registers, and also at this time, we'll gather our families. more blessed ourselves to give than to receive. Amen. Heavenly Father, in your word, you show us our sin and how much we need your mercy and forgiveness. Create in us a hunger and thirst for the gospel, and then satisfy that craving every day as we turn to your word.
In all our needs, comfort us with your precious love and promises in Christ.
Send your Spirit to give us the motivation and self-discipline to seek you in your word regularly and intently. By your Spirit's guidance in your word, show us where we are weak in our lives as your disciples.
Forgive us and renew us through the gospel, so that we can live a life that brings you praise until we praise you in glory with the saints and angels in heaven.
In your word, you tell us to pray not only for friends, family, and fellow believers, but for all those in authority and even our enemies.
So we ask that you would guide those who govern us, teach us, and protect us. Help us to respect them and use them to bless us as you see fit. Turn the hearts of those who oppress us to you, and change their hearts by your powerful word and powerful love in Christ.
Give comfort and peace through your word to those who are ill and hospitalized, to those who are weary and weak, to those who grieve and mourn, to those who are anxious and afraid, to those who are afflicted with doubts and despair. Keep in your gracious care Matt Rutherford, a co-worker of Teresa Simpson who has been severely injured in an accident at work, Amy Finch, who is recovering from surgery, and Dan White, who is hospitalized. Assure them that you will give them just what is right at the right time in your tender mercy.
Give us grace to say and live the confession that God's word is our greatest treasure.
Thank you.
disciples saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. Spirit for the remission of all of your sins. May it strengthen and preserve you in the true faith and life everlasting.
Thank you.
our picnic last week. Hope I don't forget anybody. Tara Haber organized the games. I think she had some help from a couple of people, the condensed people. Maybe somebody else, am I forgetting anybody? Also, Al Waldron, Justin Shulman, Rick and Teresa Simpson, Nick and Pat Tijot, and Dan Rockers really helped to put on the meal and get things organized, so thank you to them too. Hope many of you enjoyed that opportunity for Christian Fellowship last week. Also, I would like to simply let you know that just before the service, Jerry Rexon shared with me that Verizon is giving away school backpacks July 30th, noon to 3 p.m., so no purchases necessary, one free backpack with school supplies per child. So if you have kids who are young, backpacks, I guess, are pretty nice. Just thought you might be interested in that. If you want one of the little flyers, I've got probably at least 10 of them here, so I'd be happy to share them with you on the way out. Any other announcements? Seeing none, may the Lord bless you or David.